All right, well, have any of you ever been really, really thirsty? All right, I don't know if you've ever forgotten water. Water's pretty important, right? I think that probably the one time I remember being really, really thirsty was a time that Marissa and I were a couple months married. I was stationed at Fort Carson as an infantry officer, and I said, you know, I want my wife to love what I love. Let's go climb one of the 14ers in Colorado, and I chose one of the easier ones, Mount Princeton. So I just gotten out of Ranger school, so I was in pretty good shape, and I thought, you know what, that'll be great. And so we went up there, but here was the problem. I only packed water for one person. I forgot that I had two people with me. And so things were going fine. The other thing that I forgot was that I said it's only a 3-mile hike from the base to the mountain. What I didn't tell her is that it was an 8-mile hike from the parking lot to the base. So we got started late. We didn't have any water. And then there was an extra, you know, 10 or so mile hike. And so we didn't get up to above Timberline till afternoon. If you know anything about Colorado, the thunderstorms roll in. It's very dangerous afternoon to be up on a 14er because a lot of people are killed by lightning. Do you think that made any difference? No, I said, oh, it doesn't look too bad. And so anyway, sure enough, about 3 or 4 o'clock, I'd already pushed my wife past the breaking point about 3 or 4 times. And we came around the corner, and we were about 500 feet from the summit. We came around and just hit this massive wind of about 40 miles per hour, and it was like this, and I'm like, isn't this fun? And she's like, I'm going down now. Best decision of my life. I did not summit. But on the way back, though, I realized how thirsty we were. We ran out of water, and we actually had to go across this glacier, only about a foot wide. Some guys had channeled a little ledge that you could go across. She didn't like that very much, 1,000 feet down. And so we went across that back in the dark. So all the things not to do, but I'm talking about thirst here. So that's actually, I guess, a double application. Don't do what I do, right? Lead with a lot more love and planning. But also as far as thirst, that was really thirsty because we ran out of water. And we almost like, wow, how are we going to get down because we were just so thirsty. And I remember when we finally did get back down at the bottom, we were just so exhausted. It was one of just the most intense exhaustions, you know, we've ever felt in our life. And that was the other moment where I saved my marriage as I got back in the car. And I remember that I just leaned the seat all the way back down like we were going to go to sleep and just rest. She's like, oh, no, you are taking me to a hotel now. Second best thing I ever did. But anyway, so what not to do in the first couple months of marriage. But spiritual thirst is something that I think, if we're really honest, some of us are spiritually thirsty. Many of you are spiritually anemic. I think it's always true, if we are really honest, that a lot of us go days, maybe even months, not in the Word, not in prayer, and then we wonder why we're so depressed. I really think that one of the biggest solutions with depression is what I call going back to the basics. If someone came to a physical doctor and said, I just don't know what's wrong with me. And the doctor says, well, have you eaten or drank anything last? No, I haven't eaten for days, or I haven't drank water all day yesterday. We're like, well, of course, that's it. But Jesus in this passage is going to say, come to me, all who are thirsty. And out of your inmost being, out of your heart will flow streams or rivers of living water. And this actually, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. And I would say to us, how many of you, if you're really honest, you're empty. You haven't been consistent in the Word. You haven't been constant in prayer. You're not committed to fellowship. You're not courageous in witnessing. You're not continually in worship, because really the focus is on yourself. And when we get focused on ourselves and our feelings and our circumstances and this fallen world, can we not get pretty discouraged and empty and thirsty? But Jesus is the only one who totally satisfies. And you've heard me say it many times, one of the greatest times of depression in college. I remember I went to church on a Tuesday night. My brother drugged me to a Bible read-through, which was being led by a Navy SEAL. And the idea there is you read 12 chapters a day, and you read through the entire Bible in 4 months. And it was interesting that as I reluctantly embarked in that, as I saturated my mind with Scripture, my feelings and perspective eventually changed. Can I tell you all that that's true of you? If your perspective and your emptiness, your spiritual thirst is you're dry and you're depressed, you're down, can I tell you this? Saturate your mind with Scripture. the truth of God's word, and your feelings and your perspective will eventually change. You're just spiritually dehydrated. In fact, one guy in a soccer team doing some cycling with, he and I, the father and I like to cycle, and they call it in cycling, anybody know what bonking is? If you bonk, all right, it's a cycling term basically where if your glycogen comes and is completely depleted, you can even, you know, you just completely can't even hardly walk. You just have to have a place where you have, your body has to have rest, has to have food, has to have water. I think some of you are in spiritual bonk, all right? You're in spiritual funk, but you've bonked. You're just completely depleted of the Lord's spiritual input in your life. And as we're going to read here, that comes through the Holy Spirit. How can you be filled with the Spirit if you're not walking with the Spirit? And how can you walk with the Spirit if he's not side by side with you? And how can you be side by side if you're not inputting the word and you're not pouring out your heart and casting all your cares in prayer? And if you're not with God's people to be re-energized? I know I am re-energized every single Sunday. I need, without Sunday, I would bonk. I sometimes even bonk on Mondays. Mondays is the most depressing day for a pastor because you kind of come and at the end you're like, oh. But I want to come to you and say, Jesus has come. Come to him today and know that if you're spiritually thirsty, he will satisfy. And through his Spirit, he can really allow you to be fully satisfied. If you're new with us, we're going through the New Testament, all right, and specifically the four Gospels. We're studying all four Gospels together in chronological order, putting all the events of Christ's life in the sequence as they happened. So we're taking on Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We've been in this study for about 5 years. We got a little ways to go. And we want to be conformed to his life. As we study his perfect life, we want to be conformed to his perfect life, or better, more like his perfect life. We've just finished his Galilean ministry, about 18-month-long period, where Christ had to flee from Jerusalem, where they wanted to kill him, up north to a more prosperous and receptive audience up there among and around the Sea of Galilee. But now he's turning his attention to go to Jerusalem to die. And we're in the section, the last 6 months of his life, which the book of Gospel of John and the Gospel of Luke exclusively record. Matthew and Mark do not have these sections, where John covers the Judean ministry and Luke covers the Perean ministry. This is the last 6 months before Jesus goes and dies on the cross. So that's the section that we're at in Scripture. And our specific place that we're in right now is called the Feast of Tabernacles, where Jesus is going to come to the Feast of Tabernacles. This is around October in their calendar year. It was the last feast, Jewish feast of the year, and it was the pinnacle. It's the greatest feast, the last one, the greatest one in the calendar year. And who can remind me or help me remember what the Feast of Tabernacles is about? And I'll get to this slide in a second. Remember, the Feast of Tabernacles was a commemoration of Jesus taking the children of Israel 40 years in the wilderness supernaturally. Their clothes didn't wear out. Their sandals didn't wear out. They were fed supernaturally by God through manna from heaven. Moses could strike a rock and water would pour out. And this nation was preserved for 40 years directly from the hand of God. And so the commemoration was, is they would have a feast that would start on a specific day, would be in this month, and it would go from, the first day was a Sabbath, a special day of rest. It would go a whole week long and would end on that same day with another Sabbath. So it was bookend by two Sabbath rests. And so today we're going to see it's at the last day of the feast. This is probably that very last Sabbath rest where now everyone's taking a break from their jobs and coming to hear the rabbis teach in the temple. And Jesus then is going to stand up and teach. And actually, obviously, there's going to be great opposition to what he's teaching, that he is the source of thirst. Part of the ceremonies that would happen is they would always come and symbolically take a jar of water from the Pool of Siloam and come and bring it into the temple. And I think it's in this context, this backdrop, that Jesus says, hey, you're seeing the ceremony of this water and how God has fed and given water to the thirst of this nation. But I ultimately am the one who can satisfy your thirst. So we see this is the backdrop of this. And also during the Feast of Tabernacles, the entire, a million people would be filled into Jerusalem. And they would all camp out. It was a week-long camping thing because all of them would then build little booths or tabernacles, little tents, and to commemorate that God led the people by a cloud of smoke by day and fire by night, and that God preserved them in this time. And at night was a great celebration of dancing and singing and celebration. And to commemorate the fire by night, they would light up cauldrons of fire all around the temple, where now you have the city on the hill, and then the temple is the highest pinnacle of this hill, where all around you could just see this blazing white temple aglow as the light of God leading the nation. And we're going to see then in future times, when Jesus is also not going to say he's not only the water that gives, that truly satisfied, that he is the light of what? I am the light of the world. And someday, I truly believe we, in fact, I know, I'm going to share some scripture. It says in the millennial kingdom, when Christ comes back and reigns from Israel as the king of Israel for 1,000 years, and we will get to rule and reign with him, everyone who truly believes in him, Jew and Gentile will be one people of God during that time. That says any nation that doesn't come and worship Jesus at the Feast of Booths, there's no rain given to that nation through the rest of the year. So it says Egypt comes up and worships God. I mean, an Arab nation, an Islamic nation right now is going to come and ultimately come and worship King Jesus and celebrate the Feast of Booths? Yes. Amazing. So this is the context of what we're in. We said that Jesus is the fulfillment of the 7 Jewish feasts. He's fulfilled 4. He's going to fulfill 3 more. So there's a lot of people new with us. So those of you who've heard this before, bear with me. This is for them. Jesus fulfilled the Passover, the first feast. How? How did Jesus fulfill the Passover? Where and when? At the cross, right? He bore the sin of all the world, so that if the blood of Jesus is applied to someone's heart, the wrath of God will pass over them in the coming judgment. And I still ask you, does the blood of Jesus cover each of your hearts? Otherwise, you will not be passed over when it comes judgment time. Then we see the feast of, the next one is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And they had a tradition of obviously covering the bread that was unleavened, that was, it signified the sinlessness of Christ. But it was buried, it was covered. Was Jesus in the grave 3 days and 3 nights, according to Matthew 12? Yes, he fulfilled the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And it says he went and he led captives in his train. I believe he went to Sheol, the place of the dead, and liberated the half side of those who have faith prior to the coming of Christ, paradise, Abraham and all the saints, and allowed them, because of the atonement was made, to then go into the presence of God in heaven. Then we see also he fulfilled the next one, which is first fruits. When did Christ fulfill first fruits? He was the first one who raised from the dead. He fulfilled first fruits at the resurrection. The fourth one he fulfilled at the giving of the Holy Spirit at the day of Pentecost, the Feast of Weeks. But we still see there's 3 more feasts that need to be fulfilled for the nation of Israel. I do believe these are for Israel, not the church. When will the Feast of Trumpets be fulfilled for the nation of Israel? When is the last trumpet, the second coming, the day of the Lord, when Christ comes back, saves Israel from annihilation because a northern army is coming to attack them in the Valley of Decision, the Valley of Jehoshaphat, what we call Armageddon, and Christ saves them miraculously from that advancing army when he comes back the second time, and Romans 11 says at that point, the whole nation of Israel will finally be saved and recognize Yeshua as Mashiach, as their Messiah. The Feast of Trumpets. Then we know that from there, there's going to be, it says on that day, there'll be a national day of atonement, Yom Kippur, right? And we have a day of where the whole nation, it says, will come into that Jeremiah 31:31 covenant, where he'll remember their sins no more. And finally, the Feast of Tabernacles, the one we're in right now, will be a celebration where Christ rules and reigns from Jerusalem for 1,000 years. And this will be commemorated every year. Did you know that you guys will celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles 1,000 times yet in the future? At least 1,000. Every year in the millennial kingdom, you and I will celebrate this feast. So should you get ready to know about the true holiday you're about to celebrate in the future? July 4th. Christmas. Ha! Well, not Christmas, sorry. But I think it's been moved, and it's kind of been, what I mean is the commercialization of Christmas. Sorry, Lord. I meant the bad parts of how we've really denigrated Christmas. Your birth, yes, I'm sure we'll celebrate it whenever that true day was. I don't think it probably was December 25th. Constantine moved it. Anyway, that's a whole big deal. Okay, we better move on. All right, but this is a fulfillment. So here's the picture of them lighting up of the tabernacle during the Feast of Tabernacles. The celebration, the booth still that the Jews celebrate this feast even today. They call it Sukkah or booths. And the cloud of smoke by day as they would offer sacrifice, and people would see that smoke going forth. The lighting of the temple, going to be a much better than this artist's depiction, much better. It's going to pale. We see that Christ, where is he giving this teaching? Probably in the portico or the Solomon's colonnade, which was this covered portrait where you could really, it's massive. You could teach thousands of people, and because of the acoustics, they could listen to Jesus. And we've gone all over this, but this is the context of where this is happening. Solomon's porch, 1 million people can fit into the court of Gentiles. Gentiles can go into this open court, but only the inner court could Jews go into, with the court of women, the court of men, then the court of priests, and then only the high priest could go into the temple, the Holy of Holies, once a year. So that's the context. We've just read our passage that this is the last day, so it's 8 days long. This is the eighth day, the last Sabbath, when he's going to stand up, and they call it the great day because it was the final, you know, culmination, the entire holiday in which they said. And so notice he says, he cries out, he literally yells out, if anyone's thirsty. Now, why would he probably yell out? He wanted everyone in that colonnade, in that temple, to hear him, didn't he? And this was so in fact because this is talking, I believe, about spiritual thirst. Is he talking about physical thirst? No, they had physical water. But really you could say, is anyone spiritually thirsty? Let him come to me and drink. Can I tell you, there is a physical part of you and a spiritual part of you. So many people try to fill even the spiritual part of them with physical things of this world. And they wonder then why they're so empty. I always tell my teenagers, you always see people who, isn't it interesting, they call alcohol spirits, right? Because I believe when you get drunk, you open yourself up to, you know, to do stupid things by the influence of demonic spirits. But even that, it never satisfies, does it? Because it has to be done over and over and over again. And they never show you on TV the morning after, where someone's praying to the porcelain god, you know what I mean? Okay, that's all I'll say. All right, they never show that because it's empty. It doesn't satisfy. I was at the gas station last night after our men's retreat and just waiting there for the gas, and I just saw all these people, you know, coming in, loud music, partying, drinking, carry on, and you could hear some of that even at the rec center where we had our retreat, and I thought, guys, that's just so empty. People who party and they seek out, but they're going after something that really only that God-shaped void can be filled by the Lord. And they can try to fill so many things, but it will never satisfy. You've heard Calvin or one of our elders' testimony, how he tried to live and fill himself with the things of this world, and he was so empty, and only Christ fulfilled him. Because Christ is yelling out, come to me, only I can give you this satisfaction. And notice how you do that. He who believes in me, as Scripture says, the in his inmost being, in his truly his heart, his bowels will flow rivers of living water. And what's he saying here? We know what this means. He's speaking of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. This shows us, what's the proof that you've truly believed and come to Jesus to satisfy your spiritual thirst? How does God mark the true believer? He indwells them with the Holy Spirit. So if you never have the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, those rivers, that means the Holy Spirit's not in your life. If the Holy Spirit's not in your life, it means you haven't yet believed. You haven't come to Jesus alone to satisfy you. Because the Spirit is the proof. The Spirit is the mark that God puts in every person to say, they belong to me. I own them. They've come and drank from my stream, which is Jesus Christ alone. And they are my adopted sons and daughters. And so we see that those who believe, they from their inmost being flows rivers of living water. This is the Holy Spirit, and I think the fruits of the Spirit. And it says, but the Spirit himself was not given at this time because Christ was not yet glorified. There's a whole nother focus there. I'm not going to focus on that today. But it says, from this point, though, then we see a division in the crowd of all the different kinds of people. People of various points of belief. Some say he's a prophet. Now, let me ask you this. Will you be saved if you believe Jesus is just the prophet? You respect him? You think he prophetically speaks as God, as one of the Old Testament prophets? But if you think Jesus is just an Old Testament prophet, are you truly saved? Why? Let me give this idea. A mere man, a created being, his life is only good as a one-for-one exchange. If Jesus is God, his life, his powers has infinite value, infinite worth to cover infinitely any number of sinners. a prophet who dies for you, the best he could do is for himself, probably. But Christ is God, obviously, without any blemish, is infinite. He has infinite power. He alone has power over nature, over life and death, over eternity, over Satan. You don't need a mere man, a created being. That's why the Mormons believe Jesus was a created being. Every cult, Jehovah's Witnesses, Muslims, they all believe Jesus was a created being, a mere man. A mere man cannot save you. A mere man cannot eternally satisfy your thirst any more than you, a mere man, can satisfy anybody else's mere thirst. Let's be honest. As great as marriage is and all that comes with marriage, does that area of your life ever fully satisfy you completely for all that you're, you know? Sex can only go so far. Power can only go so far. Position can only go so far. Possessions can only go so far. But only the Lord. Because why? God made you to hunger for Him. In the heart of every man is a hunger and thirst that can only be satisfied by relationship with their Creator. And when that's separated, when that's broken, when that's non-existent, my friends, you will be and always will be empty. You always will be thirsty. And there is no solution other than coming to Jesus for the solution. So some say he's a prophet, but others get it right. He is the Christ, the Christos, which is a Greek term referring to the Hebrew term Mashiach. He is the appointed one or the anointed one, the one who will save Israel, the one who will save the world. Remember that says that Jesus in Matthew says he will save his people from their what? Their sins. And John tells us he's not only propitiation for our sins, but for the sins of the entire what? World. So we see some here get it right. They say he's the Christ because they say he's more. He's come from God. He, and as we know, he is even one with God. He is the Christ. But then others, obviously, we see the division. Surely the Christ is not going to come from Galilee. Isn't it interesting they were ignorant? Where was Jesus truly from? He grew up in Nazareth, but where was he born? Bethlehem. People thought he was, you know, an illegitimate child, but really he fulfilled Isaiah 7 that he was born of a what? A virgin. Totally ignorant of this, and they just know the external. Oh, he's the carpenter's son, and he has these brothers. He's from Nazareth. This guy can't be our Messiah. Well, you don't know, because I don't think they really wanted to know, many of them. And so then notice, but some didn't know the scripture. Has not the scripture said that Christ comes from the sins of David from Bethlehem? The village where David was. Where in scripture does it say that? Micah 5:2. Right? Let's go ahead and look there to know what they're referring to. So you can see exactly in print in your Bibles. One of those 12 minor prophets. It takes a while sometimes. Let's see. Jonah, Micah. There we go. Thank you, Lord, for helping me turn there quickly. All right, Jonah, Micah 5:2. But as for you, Bethlehem, Bethlehem means house of bread. That was the name what Bethlehem means. Bethlehem, all right, is, but you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, for from you will go forth me, the ruler of Israel. There we go. There was the prophecy. So then we also see that a division occurs in the crowd. Some of them wanted to seize him, but no one laid out their hands on him. Now, why did some want to seize him? When he says, come to me for all who are thirsty, what is he really saying? I can satisfy you on a spiritual level as only God can, which is this very similar to his claims as we're going to read in the rest of John. John 8:58, before Abraham was, I'm the I am. All right, going back to Exodus 3 where Moses says, who are you? And God says, tell him that I am sent you. I am that I am. So Jesus claims to be I am in John 8:58. And John 10:30, they pick up stones of stone because he says before, the Father and I are what? Are one. This was similar. That's why they were trying to seize him, because he's saying, I can satisfy in the way that only God can satisfy. Eternally, with the Spirit, as out of you will flow rivers of water. Well, this is blasphemous to those who didn't believe he was God. So they wanted to seize him. This is the group of the Pharisees. So the officers then came to the chief priests and Pharisees, and they said, why did you not bring him? Apparently, some even gave the order to the temple guard. The Jews did have their own temple police, that police, the immediate temple area. Why did they have their own temple police? Very quickly, the Romans couldn't come into the temple area because they thought that would defame or make the temple unclean. So they had their own temple police made up of just Jews. So they send them to go arrest Jesus. They don't do it, and they says, hey, why did you bring him in? And what do they say? No one has ever spoke the way this man has. Of course, then notice their you know, the vitriol here. They said, he has not led you astray, has he also, you temple police guys? For they said, not a one of the rulers or Pharisees have believed him, meaning, hey, toe the line here, kids. But this crowd doesn't know the law, and they are cursed. Can I tell you, it's a little stronger in the Greek. The law, they're ignorant, they're stupid, they are damned. Think of the pride there. We know the law so much, we think we can get to God by just obeying the law. Isn't it ironic? If you try to obey the law according to Romans 3, what does it say? And we're at Romans 2. It says, many of the Jews, says they thought they knew the law, but he says, do you who know the law, do you obey it? And of course the answer is what? No one obeys it perfectly in thought or in deed. And it says, we alike, Jew and Gentile alike, are all under or condemned under what? The condemnation of sin. Therefore, there has to be an external source of righteousness. So it's truly them who are cursed and are damned, trusting in their own righteousness for God to accept them, when God will not accept that, but they put that on the crowd. And then we get a little insight here, where we've last heard about Nicodemus back in John chapter 3, where Nicodemus, who is one of the Pharisees, and Jesus even calls him the teacher of Israel. Some have surmised that he might have been the primary teacher, the primary spokesman who taught in the temple regularly, that here he's one of the chief teachers, and he came to Jesus in John chapter 3 when? At night, secretly, asking about what it means to be born again. And Jesus says, if you're not born again, you will not enter the kingdom. And Jesus says, you don't know these things? You're the teacher. You're the main teacher. And I think Nicodemus probably at this point is probably not saved, but he's seeking. And here again, we see that he's not, you know, all in and saying, hey, I'm a Jesus follower. You guys are all wrong, because I'm sure they would have killed him right there and then. He kind of takes this diplomatic approach where he comes and he says, well, wait a minute. Our law doesn't allow us to judge a man unless we first hear him and actually, you know, test what he's actually doing. Does it? You kind of see this posture, this diplomatic posture? He's seeking. And, of course, notice the vitriol right back. You're not also from Galilee, Nicodemus, are you? Go search. You're the great prophet. You know no one comes from Galilee as a true prophet. And then what's interesting is that we have John 7:53 through 8. It's not in the earliest of the manuscripts. I don't know what happened here, but it just says everyone went to his home. Everyone went home. You know, just, hey, we don't want to fight about it. I don't know. So this is the context here. Let me give you then a few basic ways in which I broke this down outline-wise. That was the overview. Here now is the depth. So some of you like the overview, and you're like, okay, now Chad's going to go deep. Yep. So all you meat eaters, take the dive with me. Here we go. All right. First of all, I would say that this thirst, we need to remember, goes back to what Jesus had said earlier in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Is that a promise God's going to take to the bank for you? A true Christian, a true believer, a true follower of Jesus Christ has a promise. If you hunger and thirst for righteousness, you might be satisfied. You what? Will be satisfied. And I would say, how many of us are taking God at his word and taking that promise to the bank? Some of you are saying, well, my quiet time's kind of dry lately. I would probably say this. There could be sin in your heart, which allows the word of God not to mean much to you. You're kind of blinded. But can I tell you this? I also usually believe it's a matter of heart attitude and saturation, time. You know, you don't let your kids, how many of you guys allow your kids to be what I call bird peckers? You get it, they take a little bite and they say, I don't like that. And then sometimes if you actually get a little kid to actually eat the whole thing, they're like, oh, I do like that, right? Can I say some of you are just pecking at the word and you're like, it doesn't satisfy. That's because you didn't eat the whole course. You know, if you're doing most of your quiet times, all right, in Leviticus, I'm not saying I don't like Leviticus, or you're in the genealogies and Chronicles. Okay, yeah, you guess you. There are certain books that minister more to me than others, but I would say it's usually not a matter of the scripture being dry. It's a matter of you being dry and only eating in small quantities. Are you hungry? Are you thirsty? The promise is you'll be satisfied. This word means that you will be fattened. You can't get fat on the word if you never eat. Right, guys? Okay. He feeds, he fills you up. This is where we get the word satisfied. It was like an analogy they use for, obviously, if you wanted to have good cattle, they had to eat lots of grass. Even had a word that kind of corresponded there in the original language. Literally means to feed, satisfy, fill up. And so this is where we see this word coming from. Remember Jesus said the same thing in John 4, the woman at the well? He says, if you only knew who was here, that the gift of God is right here in front of you, and you say, give me a drink, I would have given you living water. She thinks he's talking about mere food. He says, you have nothing to draw with? You're not greater than our father Jacob, are you? And he says, everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again, speaking of the well, Jacob's well. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give shall never thirst. But the water I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. Where does this water, the satisfaction of Jesus, where does it ultimately conclude or end up? Eternal life. Guys, this is an awesome promise. John 6, we see also this concept here, that he's the bread who's come down out of heaven. He's the manna, the ultimate manna of God. And they said to him, Lord, always give us this bread. And he said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger. He who believes in me will never thirst. But let's remind what we said believe is in this word in the Greek, pistuo, right? It comes from the word pistis, was faith. And pistis, faith, comes from pitho, which means to persuade or have confidence. True belief is a trust in Christ. True belief is a faithfulness to Christ. And true belief is a confidence in Christ, right? It's not hoping, oh, I hope Jesus is the God, he's the true deal, I hope Christianity is the real way. It's you have come to know it is the way, the truth, and the life. And that's why faith is even a gift. Is Psalm 42 true of your life? As a deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night. Well, they say to me all day, where is your God? And of course, David goes through then his struggle. But he says, my soul pants for God. Can I say to you, what do you pant for? What do you long for? One thing that I realize is, as my boys love sports, no amount of football on Sunday afternoon satisfies me. Nothing in the world gives me satisfies me. It's interesting. Can I tell you the closest thing that satisfies me? This is interesting. Deep conversation with fellow believers. Quantity time. Substantive conversation time is the closest, the greatest wellspring that fills me up. But it's only a little taste. Because that very thing we have with one another is what we should have with God all the time and will have with God in the future. Enjoyed having Travis and Crystal. One thing I like about having them over is they do some of the talking. I don't have to just do all that. Anybody ever be with people who don't ask any questions and you just have to draw people out the whole time? It's exhausting. I like it because I can draw them and then they draw us. And we can just go, you know, it's like we start the thing and it just goes. And it's great because they take a genuine interest and there's deep conversation and we can catch up and we can really know what's going on in each other's life. Guys, learn that value, but it's only a taste. It's only a drop of what the Lord wants to have. And I would say to you, here's a challenge for me. Have I had a conversation with God on the same level of time that 2 or 3 hours we had? Watching the Broncos win, by the way. Do I have a longer conversation with God as I had with Travis this week? Did I have as long a conversation as the time I spent with my wife? And I think the answer is typically no. And that's why then this should be no surprise when we're struggling. Because we're not panting after the living God. All right, here's the outline. Jesus totally satisfied. Can I tell you why real quickly as I just thought about this? I said, Lord, how do we know you're the one who's satisfied? One is Jesus gave you your life. He's the life giver. You wouldn't even be here if he hadn't created you. He created you, and he knows exactly how he created you, which is for relationship, not only with others, but with him. And if you don't have that, you'll never even be even close to being satisfied. But he's not only the life giver, he is the salvation giver. You'll never have spiritual fulfillment and there's that enmity with God will never be overcome unless you come by faith and repent and ask Christ to be your Savior and Lord because he actually provided it at the cross. But as we see here, he's referring to something that's going to happen in the future. He is the Spirit giver. The only people who truly have the Holy Spirit are those who have first believed and entrusted their entire life to the Lordship of Jesus. Amen? So someone says, oh, I have the Spirit. Well, you don't have the Spirit unless you have Jesus, because he's the Spirit giver. He's the one who gives it according to this passage. And in the future, he will be the kingdom giver. He will be the eternal life giver. So I want to say to you, what do you guys have without Jesus? And your answer is what? Nothing. John 8, without him, we're absolutely nothing. So he's the source of everything. That's why he says, come to me and drink. I want to encourage you to read this book if you get a chance. It's out of print, but I found a few copies on Amazon for 1 cent, $3.99 shipping, $4, worth it. This I read in high school, got off my dad's shelf. Dad, I don't know if you remember this book. This is not Neil T. Anderson, another guy who's on the strange side of psychology. This is a missionary with Wycliffe, went to Papua New Guinea with the Falopa people, and he was translating the scripture and couldn't find the right name to express to them the concept of God. And the book goes through all these different things until he comes to the place where the spring comes from the ground and that they draw water. And they called it Bete, which means source. And they realized without that water, that spring, they would have no life. They drew from that spring. It watered their crops. It watered all the trees, the jungle they lived in. And they said, Bete, the source. And that was the name that best then unlocked the New Testament passage where God obviously is the source of all things. Is God not your source of all things, the giver? And I encourage you to read that book, but that just reminded me because the Lord is the source, that wellspring, and it's inexhaustible. And he is where it starts from, it originates, and it all goes back to it. So from him and through him and to him are what, the scripture says? All things. He's the source. Number two, we not only see that only Jesus satisfied, but the crowd is totally divided. Why are they divided? Because it reminds us of who man is without Christ. When we think we know better than God, when we think, oh, I can live life for myself and what I want, and this life is for me to be happy. Wrong, wrong, wrong. You were made to love God and know God and serve God and worship God, and until you give your life back to that purpose, you will and always will be empty and off course. Why? Your mind is depraved before your salvation. You think you see clearly, but you don't. It's just the heart is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? Jeremiah 17:9. Your heart is divided. Anybody ever kind of see, even as a Christian, sometimes you're double-minded, half-hearted? Part of you can sin one day and worship the other, and you're like, how can I be so schizo in myself? Maybe it's just me talking to myself. That's weird. All right? You're like, Chad talks himself. He said schizo of himself. That's weird. Okay. You're like, that explains a lot. Okay. But man's soul is devoid. Your spirit is made to sup, to abide, to enjoy that deep fellowship of God. But when you're in estranged from God, living for yourself, it's devoid, and you are damned. You are an object of God's wrath. You're just waiting God's judgment. And in your own strength, you one day will grow old and you'll die, and you're decrepit, you're debilitated, and you're frustrated because you're like, I try so hard and I want to just solve everything myself, but you can't. You can't do it on your own without God. You are totally dependent on God, whether you want to or not. Can I prove that to you even for the unbeliever? What if tomorrow morning all these atheists, all these confident people deny Christ, don't believe in God? What if God didn't roll up the sun tomorrow morning? That would, I think, bring them into quick understanding. Oh, I have no control over my next heartbeat. I have no control over the next sunrise. If it doesn't rain in this land, right, and all of a sudden green Maryland goes brown like California, there would be some people freaking out, right? Because they're totally dependent on whether we like it or not. How many of you decided to live and you just showed up? All of a sudden you have existence because you had nothing to do with it. You're totally dependent upon God. This reminded me of one of my favorite tracks, Christian tracks. It's a 40-page track. It's probably the most thorough explanation of the gospel. Read it sometime, but it's pretty straightforward. It's right in your face. He says, sin is it's a disease. And he says, you are debased, you are defiled, and you are defiant. And that's true of all of us if we're truly, really honest. I urge you to download the slides off our website to read the most of this. Let's move on. MacArthur, in his sermon on this, said there was dense confusion in the crowd. There was divided conviction. There was derisive contempt. People were trying to kill him, but some were believing in him. And so there's this great division, and there's four types of people here. There's the convinced. They say, this is the Christ, and many in the crowd believed in him. Then there's the contrary, those trying to kill him, the Pharisees. They want to seize him. Why didn't you bring him in, they say. And anyone who doesn't believe like we do is accursed or damned, but even though they're the ones who are damned. Then there's the confused. The temple guards are like, we want to obey these guys, but no one spoke as this man speaks. And then there's the seeker, the contemplative, who says, let's still judge the matter and give this more time and thought. Can I urge you, even if you're not sure where you're at with the Lord, give him the time to do a full, thorough investigation as you would do with your own eternity. Is your eternity worth the investigation and the time, the thought, to read through the entire Bible, check the claims of Christ for yourself? Absolutely is. Number three, evil leaders are totally thwarted. Isn't it interesting? The divine God of this universe had to die at Passover, at twilight, between the days, literally in the Hebrew, between the days, Nisan 14, and we see that he had to die at that exact time. They tried to kill him here, didn't they? But they were thwarted. Even God overran the guards, and so, hey, we didn't even bring him in. What? Because they were thwarted. They justify them, and so the unbelievers are justifying murder. They attack and threaten anyone who opposes them. They base their judgments on their own logic and opinions rather than on God. Can I tell you, some of you are so depressed because you've really put your mind and your logic, as limited as it is, as the authority of life, the determiner, instead of a authority and a knowledge much higher than yourself. And that's what's wrong with the Pharisees. The unbelievers, they use power and position, fear tax, control people. They say, oh, no one believes, none of the Pharisees believe this, or, hey, check the scripture, he doesn't come from Galilee. Same kind of fear tactics and kind of intimidation tactics we see in politics in these days on both sides. Unbelievers do anything to preserve their own pride, possessions, power, and pleasure. Jesus was threatening their livelihood. Why? Because the Pharisees and the ruling aristocracy were exploiting people in the temple. You went to come worship God in the temple, you had to come and exchange it into temple currency. Well, there's already, where you exploit the currency rate exchange, right? Then you had to also get a kosher animal, which only they determined. And so then you brought your own goat. That wasn't good enough. You had to leave that one home. You got to buy our goat at five times the price to sacrifice to the Lord. You're too poor? Our two pigeons. I know, but you have to afford. Well, I have my pigeons. Nope, that pigeon isn't good enough. So we see they'll do anything. And so ironically, the very thing they accuse others of, damnation, is true of themselves. And basically these verses for Psalm 146, Isaiah 8, Isaiah 14, Psalm 33, Proverbs 10, Job 5, Job 42, all this says the plans of the Lord cannot be thwarted, but he thwarts the evil and wicked men in their schemings. Look at Job and his conclusion at the end of 42. He says, Lord, I know you can do all things. You're the source. That no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Amen. Who is it that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have declared which I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know. Hear now, and I will speak, and I ask you, and you instruct me. I have heard of you by hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see. Therefore I retract, I repent in dust and ashes. Lord, you have it all figured out. Let me just bask in the mystery and a dependence upon you. But you thwart the cunning, the wicked, but your plans cannot be thwarted. Last point. We end with Nicodemus, and I think it speaks to many of you who are here. Some of you are here. Nicodemus is a seeker. He seeks God, Jesus, in John 3. We see a little seeking here, a window into his life in John 7. We're not going to read about him again until the end of John, when he comes and buries Jesus along with Joseph of Arimathea. He was a private, secret follower of Christ, and probably may not even come to full commitment to Christ's lordship till after the resurrection. I want to say to you, some of you are a Nicodemus. You're seeking. And the Bible says that something's happening to you. I want you to understand what's happening to you. John 16:8 says the Holy Spirit is sent into the world to convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. May the Holy Spirit, if you're not truly saved, don't have assurance of salvation, convict you. You're not okay by your own good deeds and obeying whatever laws of God's laws you think will make you acceptable to him. It won't be enough. You're a sinner. That's the first thing you need to admit and have a change of mind and metanoia about, repentance about. You're a sinner. Your righteousness is filthy rags in God's eyes. He needs to convince you then that there's only one commodity of righteousness that you can possibly be accepted by God, and that is if you ask Jesus Christ's perfect righteousness to be credited to your account. So he convicts you of sin and righteousness. But then, you know, the last thing he's convicting you is a judgment. If you don't have that righteousness of Jesus covering your life, you will be judged. The wrath of God will fall upon you, and there will be no remedy. Isn't that what God is doing in the world with unbelievers today? And he's drawing you. That's what he's doing in Nicodemus' life. That's what he's doing in your life, according to John 16:8. He's drawing you. He says, I'll draw all men to myself. I'll be lifted up. God draws all men to himself through the cross, the message of the cross, that no matter what you've done, no matter what your past is, no sin is too great, that the cross of Christ is not greater. Amen? And he says, come to me. I'm the only solution. No man is too wicked. Hitler, if he repented, could be saved. I don't think he did. But there, even him, if he repented, could come to the cross. Even these Pharisees, they repented, could come to the cross. But they need to be illumined by the gospel. How can they hear unless someone goes and preaches them, Romans 10. So that's why if you're here today, God is hopefully using me as a Romans 10 messenger. It says, repent and believe the good news. Time is short, my friends. Believe the gospel. Trust in Jesus alone as your source for salvation. And so seekers can admire, respect, and defend, and even defend righteousness like Nicodemus. Some have said, unbelievers can't do anything good. I don't believe that according to Scripture. Nicodemus did several things good. Cornelius, a man not saved in Acts 10, did many things good. It says his prayers came up as a memorial offering before God. God then said, I'm going to go send you Peter to give you the gospel. But no amount of goodness, even if it's good for a time, can merit salvation. In that sense, you're dead in sins. You can't attain to perfection. But righteous people can defend right. In fact, even Acts 10, it says this at the end. Peter says, I now know men from any nation, those who do good or do righteous and fear God are welcome to him. Isn't it interesting? Moral fear and guilt and desire to live according to righteous, right living the way God set up in Scripture, even that in the heart of a believer is part of God giving them more light. We don't get that preached very often. Certainly a person who has no fear of God and doesn't do it right is not welcome to him. God has to convince them to get on that path. And so there's kind of a path before the path, I think Scripture sometimes talks about. Because it says it's written on your hearts, Romans 2. And it says, but they can't obey it fully, like we see in our own lives. Seekers of all nations who fear God and do it right are welcome to Acts 10:35. Seekers often pray and ask God to reveal himself as the woman in 1991. What was her name again for you, Dad, in Russia? Ellen Petrikova was praying for how many years? She said, many years. Lord, reveal yourself to me. Show your truth. And God sent Alden Laird in 1991, however empty many thousands of miles, to sit right next to her at that exact moment on that park bench in the city he did not plan to go because she asked God, show me yourself. And I would say to you, if you pray that prayer, God will not fail you. In fact, you're probably even here today as an answer if you've been saying, Lord, reveal yourself. Hopefully this sermon is part of that revealing. We see Lydia, right? She was a worshiper there on the river near Philippi. And God sent who to be right next to her? Paul, who explains the gospel, and it says God then opened her heart to receive the full gospel. But Cornelius and Lydia, though they were seekers, were they saved? And the answer is what? No. They worshiped God out of ignorance. They had to have the full gospel in order to be fully saved. Just like there are people who worship God out of ignorance today, but my friends, you and I have the gospel. Unless you go to them, they cannot be saved. So they often pray and ask God to reveal himself, like Cornelius and Lydia. They can be respected by others, but they're ignorant. They have a limited knowledge. But notice this. This is a key point. Please, I know I'm a little over time, but can I tell you something I noticed about Lydia today in Acts, I believe it's 16? It says that she was open to hearing the scriptures. One of the signs of a seeker who's truly God's drawing to himself is willing and open to someone opening the scriptures and explaining them. Someone who is close and far away from God says, when I ask them, hey, can I open the scripture and show you what Jesus, how Jesus answers that question as far as what the source of salvation or how exactly you get saved? They say, no, that's okay. But Lydia said, show me. And I would say, if you're here listening to the word, this is a good sign. You're hearing the word of God preached, this is a good sign. You're saying, show me. And hopefully God's using me in a small way, I'm sure unperfect way, to say, here are the answers. It's there. They're willing to listen and read the scriptures. My friends, if you ever witness to someone and they're willing to open the Bible, that is a good sign. When someone says, nah, don't even open that thing. It's almost like it's this weird power force thing. You start to crack up the pages and they're like, you know, close the door, right? There was one time Russ and I were witnessing someone, we started quoting scripture, and literally the woman started backing away. You're like, I'm just quoting the words of God. Is it that powerful? And the answer is what? Yes. They have questions like Nicodemus had questions. And my friends, some of you, many of you here have the answers. Give them the answers. What's the conclusion? I end with this slide. Can we fast forward to a glimpse of when we're truly satisfied? Let's end here. Christians, have hope. Someday, though you are thirsty and though, and just know this, I've given you this paradox. I've come to a belief to this. God will always leave me a little bit in want. God will always leave me a little bit in thirst and hunger spiritually in this life. Why? Because only he satisfies, and I will not completely be devoid of the flesh, this corruption, right, in myself, until the kingdom, until the eternal state. And here's the glimpse of this future day. When you say, I just want to be happy. Can I tell you? You will never be happy in this life, ever, not fully. So stop expecting it. Stop trying it. And start hoping in this time when you truly will. But here it is. Let me read it for you. We end here. I said to him, Lord, you know. This is John speaking. And he said to me, he's talking about martyrs who were killed in the tribulation. He says, these are the ones who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Who have they trusted in for salvation? Jesus. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. You think this church service is long, my friends? Get ready for day worship service, okay? That's all I got to say for you time watchers, all right? Day and night is temple, and he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them. They will hunger no longer, nor thirst anymore, nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb is in the center of the throne, will be their shepherd, and will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe, I love this, every tear from their eyes, every single one of your sorrows, every one of your longings, every one of your disappointments, the Lord someday is going to completely heal, amen? That is my hope. It's not in this life, it's not in this election, it's not in myself. I'm going to die an old decrepit man someday if I even live that long. But I will be with the Lord someday, and he will make all things new, amen? He will wipe every tear from my eyes, no more mourning or crying or pain. The old order of things has passed away. Behold, he says, I will make all things new. Therefore, any of you who are thirsty, come to me, and any of you who are sons, you will overcome all of this. So, Chad, stop watching the news of this. Some of you know I'm a news junkie. It's depressing. Revelation 22, last chapter in the Bible, read this with me. Here we go. Can we all read this together? And he said to me, seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Let the one who does wrong still do wrong, and the one who is filthy still be filthy. And let the one who is righteous still practice righteousness, and the one who is holy still keep himself holy. Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to render to each man according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter by the gates into the city. But outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the immoral persons and the murderers and the idolaters and everyone who loves and practices lying. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. and let the one who hears say, come, and let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who wishes to take the water of life without cost. Let's pray. Father, I pray if anyone doesn't know you, today would be the day they come. They wouldn't wait another moment, another second to come and just absolutely admit their inabilities, their emptiness, their sin, their condemnation, their guilt, and their, Lord, just their state that deserves hell. And that they instead would come to you and say, Lord, fill me up. Satisfy me in you. Give me a hope beyond myself, beyond this life. I put my faith, my hope, and my trust in you and you alone to satisfy. I repent of my sins, and I call upon you to be Lord of my life. I hope that's some of your prayer today, that you all would come. And God's people said, amen. You're dismissed.